This video is brought to you by Skillshare. Check the link in the description for up to 2 free months of valuable education. The story might be one of the few things universal to the human experience. Larger-than-life characters, plots, twists, turns, action, and suspense are part of our lives. It's almost as if it's in our genetic code. Unless you are a scientist, in which case I don't believe that, and I denounce and reject that claim. This is true in things as simple as the story we tell about our day, but also how you define yourself. In some ways, identity itself is about the stories we tell about ourselves and those told about us. A good story can change governments. It can bring people together or even justify some of the worst actions in history. The political left, from democratic socialists to Stalinists to anarchists, tell the story of the Paris Commune. It was a radical experiment in democracy in the late 19th century. For 2 months, these people fought overwhelming forces. At the same time, they tried to build the society of their dreams. Since the fall of the Commune, those on the political left, from Karl Marx to Noam Chomsky, have claimed it as a foundational myth. Historians turn raw events from the past, like the Commune, into narratives. So, you know, we have some value. Today, let's tell this story. Let's show the world what happened in Paris in 1871. Let's find out about these communards and what they have to say about the world we live in today. Let's begin with the divide in leftist activism today. Those not familiar with left-wing circles might not know, but the left is always in debate over one issue or another. The most significant divide, though, is likely over states, specifically whether they are necessary. Do we follow Karl Marx and make a government, an army, to end capitalism before it too withers away? Or do we believe the anarchist argument that no state, by definition, could serve anyone but a political elite? Both Marxists and anarchists point to the Paris Commune as their case for how to run a revolution. So, this story hits to the core of their ideological divide. People will say I insert politics into history, which is sort of like inserting water into the ocean, but whatever. I want to dig in and find out what actually happened at the Paris Commune, and what we can learn. Europe in 1871 was a messy place. The Industrial Revolution created vast quantities of new wealth. The problem is it created that wealth in an extremely uneven fashion. Many historians would argue the life of an urban wage worker was much worse than even a medieval peasant. Medieval peasant lives weren't actually as bad as we think, but that's a different video. This 19th century industrial society was urban. People crammed into massive cities. They worked long hours and barely made ends meet, if they did at all. It's a volatile mixture for revolution we see over and over again in human history. Hey, completely unrelated, but did you know that 26 people have as much wealth as the bottom 50% of humanity? Completely unrelated, but a neat fact. Many working people in Europe realized the liberal revolutions left them behind. You know, the ones which tossed the English out of America and beheaded the King of France? They seemed to result in no real changes to the working person's daily life. They merely replaced an aristocratic elite with a capitalist one. Around Europe, a new political movement began to rise. These new revolutionaries started a series of more and more radical actions. They wanted to address the gross cruelty and inequalities of the world, one way or another. These angry people pushed towards socialism or nationalism. France had always been a hotbed of radical politics, so early socialists were popular. In the age of Emperor Napoleon III, many Parisians supported a democratic republic. An organized international group of socialists, communists, and anarchists called the First Internationale was gaining popularity. With it, they developed ideas for radical changes to the way society functioned. Then, everything changed when the German nation attacked. War broke out between France and the coalition of countries not far from becoming Germany in 1870. Historians call it the Franco-Prussian War. If you were watching a much more conventional YouTube channel with a lot more subscribers, this video would be about that instead. Then we could have maps and arrows and make the wholesale slaughter of thousands of people look like a fun little war game. All right, moving on. Long story short, soldiers rode horses, fired guns, died, and the French lost the war. By September, the Germans surrounded Paris. To hold off the Germans, the French recruited less desirable men from Paris. Those enlisted from the middle and upper classes, the closest neighborhoods to, like, today's white suburbs, were pro-government and happy to serve the emperor. Those from the lower class neighborhoods were all hopped up on this radical leftism. Let's just say, leftists and emperors don't get along. Radical leftists in France noticed their army had little left to resist the Germans. They saw an opportunity to make a strike against the government. On September 19th, those lower-class soldiers marched to the center of town. These activists demanded a new government in Paris. A commune. Commune is a loaded word, but let me channel historian Donnie Gluckstein to explain.
The Paris Commune, it sounds terribly radical. You know, commune sounds to do with communism, but actually it's not. The commune was literally, and it's still the unit of local government in France. If you go around, you have the Commune de Paris, the Commune de Montpellier, the Commune of Lyon. It just means town council. And what people do is they elect the town council. When I say people, I mean the men.
But the September 19th demonstration would be the beginning of the unrest. Not the end. Leftist protesters who wanted a commune in Paris would meet again on October 5th and 8th. Then things started to change after a failed attempt to break the German siege. France's defense minister, fearing capture, escaped Paris by hot air balloon. On October 28th, Parisians learned the Germans surrounded another French army, the bulk of their remaining men. Yet another attempt to break the German lines had failed with heavy losses. On October 31st, leaders of revolutionary groups in Paris called for major demonstrations. Some 15,000 people came out to protest the government and demand a commune again. The government put the demonstration down. Yet, during this massive upheaval, the protesters stormed the local government. They even set up their own revolutionary government for a few hours. Time marched on. Unrest got stronger and stronger. It became clear there was not going to be any resolution to the war with the Germans save the French surrender. Parisians starved, froze, and starting in early January, the Germans began to shell their city day and night. Under this pressure, extreme factions of the left-wing resistance to the government got desperate. This led to real firefights with government forces. As France negotiated a ceasefire with Germany, a leftist militia called the National Guard seized 400 old bronze cannons. They took the cannons into the working-class neighborhoods in Paris. They were ready to arm themselves against the French government. Paris would be for the people. The government tried to negotiate some of them back, yet they also refused to prolong a freeze on debt collection and shuttered radical newspapers. These government actions only succeeded in making the Parisian radicals even angrier. They were now less willing to come to the table. The army tried to go and claim those cannons, planning to regroup outside the city and attack it if they refused. And, well, they refused.
So on the 18th of March, very early in the morning, they went to Montmartre. All the cannons were stored in Montmartre to keep them safe from the Prussians. And the Versailles government went and tried to seize them. And Louise Michel and various women stopped the soldiers and said, "How dare you disarm the working class? These are our cannons. Go away." The soldiers, ordinary people, refused to follow their officers' orders because the officers said, "Shoot, shoot, shoot the women." The soldiers refused to do that. They turned up their guns upside down. In other words, they were not going to fire. And they actually arrested their officer and a couple of them were killed. And at that point, the ruling class panicked and what was left of it in Paris ran away to Versailles. So Paris was left literally without any government of the bourgeoisie. What was left was the Federation. In other words, the armed soldiers, the armed working class, and they began to run Paris for themselves. And that, in a sense, is the origin of the Commune.
In really no time, Paris all of a sudden belonged to the revolutionaries. There was functionally no state. So what do you do next? The rubber would hit the road on March 28th when the new Paris Commune held their first meeting. They made imprisoned socialist leader Louis-Auguste Bonnqui their honorary president. On top of that, they abolished the death penalty and conscription and voted in a dozen other measures. Honoraries aside, it was a remarkable experiment in democracy. The Commune had no president, no mayor, no general, nothing. And they just organized commissions for running different areas of the city.
So the revolution of 18th of March takes place. The bourgeois government runs to Versailles. And then there's a debate, what do we do? There are basically two main currents that will sort of win out in the end in all the debates. There's elements of the bourgeoisie, the old mayors who ran the various arrondissements, local mayors. They're fairly bourgeois and they drift away quite fast. So you've got two currents left and the two currents are the Blanquists and the Proudhonists. And the Blanquists trace their origins way back to 1789 and 1793, and they see a sort of daring minority that take action and decide for everybody else. So Blanqui invented the concept of the dictatorship of the proletariat. It was his term, Marx sort of borrowed, and he wanted to establish this, and he was very keen on the issue of power. They say, we need to march on Versailles, destroy our enemy, and then we can construct a new society. That's the Blanquists, who sort of action by a dedicated, very mentally advanced, as they think of themselves, minority acting for everybody else. You've got the Proudhonists on the opposite side, who are anarchists, who basically say all authority is bad, and therefore we shouldn't be marching on Versailles to overthrow it, because we're not interested in authority, either to defeat it or even to construct one in Paris. We'll just, everybody should do their own thing. And then you've got the Jacobins, who are sort of in the middle, and the Jacobins are not a socialist current, actually. They're a sort of radical bourgeois current. Quite a large group, actually, but they trace their origins, obviously, back to the Jacobins of the French Revolution. These people are debating, and they say, what do we do? And the decision is, and this is the decision which I think is quite fateful, actually, they decide to hold a municipal election.
Before long, separation of church and state, abolition of rent and debt collection, and worker self-management were all law. Women also played a massive role in the commune, bucking the status of women at the time. One example is Louise Michel, who carried out both combat and the maintenance of the commune. She was a teacher and nicknamed the French Grande Dame of Anarchy. Louise helped the injured, and even reportedly grabbed a gun and uniform herself. Though, don't expect a paradise. These women still couldn't vote. No women served in the commune's decision-making body itself.
I haven't mentioned, for example, how advanced it was in terms of education for women and women's rights. It's not a thing that's often talked about, but the revolution was started by women, by Louise Michel and the people around her. The last defenders were prostitutes, companies of prostitutes who were fighting alongside the National Guards, who fought to the bitter end because they recognized the liberation in terms of equal education, equal pay, all sorts of things.
There was also long disagreement over the Bank of France. Different leftists since the fall of the commune have played Monday morning quarterback. They debate to this day whether the people who ran the commune should have raided it for the money. You'll find Monday night quarterbacking of the commune's actions quite common. It's easy to forget this radical new seed of democracy was at war with the nation of France. Granted, the whole Germany thing occupied France, but still, they weren't going to let the French capital manage themselves. The government was in Versailles. Some Parisians, such as the followers of Louis-Auguste Blanqui, wanted to send their men to march on it. Some tried, but the offensive was a quick failure, and the French army put them on the defensive. On that note, the communal military was disorganized at best. They boasted 200,000 men on paper, but to be honest, they had about a quarter of those tops. Significant percentages of the military just abandoned their posts without leave. Moreover, many of those big cannons and stuff had few people trained to use them. But like many of the best things in the world, the Paris Commune's time upon this earth was short. By the 21st of May, the French army began its offensive on the city of Paris. They found an area of the city unfortified, and French troops marched in. The disorganized military began to dissolve as the battle moved street to street. Soldiers broke ranks to save their neighborhoods. This takeover of the city is often called Bloody Week. The government wanted not only to suppress this revolt, but make sure no one would ever think to go do this again. We have stories of mass executions and mass graves yet uncovered to this day. The government exiled the few survivors around the globe. On that bright note, let's take a little break for our sponsor. Hey friends, I want to keep making high quality history content, but I also enjoy luxuries like paying rent and eating food. So I want to thank this video sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is a learning community with thousands of classes to improve your marketable skills. Since the last video I did with Skillshare, I've learned quite a bit. Premium membership gets you unlimited access to high quality classes from experts working in their fields, subjects ranging all over the place. Skillshare has tons of courses, which have made me a better filmmaker. I actually just last night finished a huge Photoshop course I loved and learned a lot from. It's also pretty light on the pocketbook, only 10 bucks a month, which you know is pretty cheap compared to like a college course, and even cheaper than a lot of websites that do the exact same thing. Also, Skillshare has given me a promo link so that if you want to check it out, and if you want to stick around, if you use the link down in the description or on the screen printed right now, you'll get 2 free months, which also, if you sign up, will help me. Like, you have no idea how much it'll help me. Thank you to Skillshare for making Step Back possible. Several prominent left-wing thinkers were alive to witness what happened at the commune. This included the big daddy of them all, Karl Marx. For left-wing activists, thinkers, and revolutionaries, the Paris Commune was a unifying story. For a short amount of time, a revolutionary experiment in democracy took place. The Commune was the model for how to run a democracy and overthrow the oppressors. That's not to say there wasn't disagreement. We can begin with the anarchists. Anarchists are a left-wing movement which espouses a strong opposition to authoritarianism. Anarchist thinker Pierre-Joseph Proudhon was influential on the Commune. Many anarchists participated in the Commune's organization. During it, many businesses reopened as co-ops under an anarchist model and were successful. Anarchists can point to these successes as an example of how their economic models do hold water. Other left-wing activists, communists and socialists, use the commune as a case study. Marxists believe the state is required to establish communism, but once capitalism is defeated, their state would wither away. They point to the commune's successes and failures to make their case for a revolutionary state. The democratic organization of the commune was a success. Yet, many Marxists would argue running the military as a democracy was more than a little responsible for the commune's downfall. And the story of the commune would continue to inspire left-wing movements. The Soviet Union sang the commune's anthem. Lenin himself celebrated when the Soviet Union had lasted longer than the Paris Commune. But whoop-de-doo, that's a great story for 19th and 20th century revolutionaries, but what does it mean for us today? I tried to paraphrase this a few times, but I'm gonna leave the last word here to Dr. Gluckstein.
I think the Paris Commune is very, very important in the sense that people say ordinary people are too stupid, too thick, not clever enough to run society. You need to have very rich, well-bred people who've been to the right schools and the right universities and have the right share portfolio, and they should run the world. And I think if that's the case, then we're all doomed. Look at global warming and all the rest of it. Look at where they're taking us. Mm-hmm. So the Paris Commune shows that ordinary people can run society. The tragedy was that there was a very, very short time for them to be able to show that. But in a sense, that's what it achieved, and that cannot be taken away.
I want to thank Dr. Gluckstein for talking to me about the Paris Commune. His book on the subject is down in the description. If you buy it, it helps me out a little bit too. I'll also have a playlist of other videos I've made about leftist revolutionaries that you can check out if you like this video. Keep strong, comrades. Keep fighting the good fight, and come back soon for more Step Back.